Perhaps you're wondering about the title of my presentation, The Copernicus of the Piano. Copernicus, you may recall, was the celebrated Polish astronomer who 300 years before Chopin came along, opened up the heavens for his successors, just as Chopin opened up the keyboard for those who came after him. In the course of the next hour or so, I hope that you'll agree that the epithet Copernicus is justified, especially when we consider what Chopin did for the future of the piano, and even for the future of music itself. As a child, Chopin was precocious. He was writing verse at the age of 6, and he composed his first piece of music at the age of 7, a Polonaise in G minor. And that led the Warsaw Press to label him a Polish Mozart. But the most remarkable thing about him was his predisposition towards the piano. As a pianist, Chopin was mostly self-taught. The only formal piano teacher that Chopin ever had was Adalbert Givini, a Warsaw-based musician who was actually a violinist, and the lessons were abandoned when Chopin was 12 years old. His chief studies were with Joseph Elsner, the director of the High School for Music, and they were for composition. In piano playing, Chopin was left to find his own way, and he did so with such a natural aptitude that by the time he was 19 years old, he was fully formed as a pianist. His celebrated set of 12 studies, Opus 10, originally called Exercises, were begun in his late teens, and they were composed to give himself new technical problems to solve. More about these seminal pieces later on. Chopin pursued his general education at the Warsaw Lyceum, where he received one of the finest educations of any of his musical peers, with the possible exception of Mendelssohn. And he attended classes in modern languages, history, classics, and drawing, a topic that was taught by the distinguished Polish painter Zygmunt Vogel. The boy's sketchbooks are filled with pencil drawings of scenes captured from various vantage points in Warsaw, and they show a talent for the visual arts. Here's a rustic image of a local windmill. And here's another, this one of Chopin's classics teacher, Dr. Samuel Linder. But music came first. That's why, after graduating from the Lyceum, Chopin enrolled in the High School for Music with Joseph Elsner, which was attached to Warsaw University. Chopin was never a student of the Warsaw Conservatory of Music, although the literature is filled with constant claims in that regard. He remained with Elsner at the High School for Music for 3 years, graduating with Elsner's final accolade ringing in his ears, Fryderyk Chopin, special ability, musical genius. The young Chopin spent many hours at Bezhezhina's music shop in the city center, browsing through the latest compositions coming out of Vienna, Paris, and Berlin. There was a piano in the adjoining room where Chopin was able to play through these newly arrived pieces, Prima Vista. It was probably on one such occasion that he came across the nocturnes of John Field. He was taken with the Irish composer's treatment of bel canto melodies in the right hand, clearly inspired by the human voice, floating above widespread arpeggios in the left hand, unfolding across a variety of harmonic progressions. Chopin, open to Field's influence and perhaps recognizing something of his future self in this music, composed his early nocturne in E minor at this time, that is, when he was about 17 years old. He didn't think the piece was worth publishing, and it remained in his portfolio until after his death. Posterity has formed a different view, and this youthful piece is now part of the standard repertory. Thank you. No one can take away from Field the honor of having invented the nocturne, but it was Chopin who made it his own, transforming it into one of the great genres of the piano repertoire. Chopin's only encounter with Field, incidentally, occurred later on in Paris in 1832, and it revealed the deep ambivalence that each composer felt towards the other, an ambivalence that stemmed from what Field regarded as Chopin's appropriation of a genre that the Irish composer had created for himself, and which provoked his notorious description of Chopin as a sick-room talent. While composing the routine exercises in harmony and counterpoint that Elsner set him, Chopin quietly worked at his own things. Some of the early mazurkas and the youthful Rondo in C minor, for example. But it's in the variations on Mozart's La ci darem la mano from Don Giovanni that the young Chopin's mastery of the keyboard stands revealed. The work probably started as an end-of-term assignment that Elsner set Chopin before the school holidays began in the summer of 1826, and it provides technical challenges in abundance. Since Chopin played these variations twice in public to great acclaim, first in Warsaw and then in Vienna, we can say that he was already a virtuoso of front rank. Mozart's Don Giovanni had entered the Warsaw Theatre's repertory as early as 1823, and that's where Chopin first heard it. The theme, La ci darem la mano, give me thy hand, O fairest, whisper a gentle yes, it's a seduction aria, one of the most famous melodies in the realm of opera. Mozart sets the scene in the key of A major, but Chopin transposes it up one semitone into B flat major, presumably for greater physical comfort at the keyboard in the difficult variations that follow. The 17-year-old Chopin now puts Mozart's theme through a series of variations filled with brilliance, facility, and the kind of bravura execution requiring what the Germans like to call Fingerfertigkeit, or finger readiness. The fourth variation reminds us that Chopin was known in Warsaw as the Paganini of the piano. The spiccato leaps for which the Italian violinist was famous, his bow bouncing back and forth across the strings, find their pianistic counterpart in this variation, the player's right hand leaping back and forth across the keyboard, plucking Mozart's theme out of the blue with no time to spare. Chopin eventually handed in his summer assignment to Elsner, and Elsner, perceiving the exceptional qualities of the work, sent the manuscript to the publisher Tobias Haslinger in Vienna. A printed copy found its way into the hands of Robert Schumann, who came out with one of the most famous imperatives in the annals of music criticism. Hats off, gentlemen, a genius. As I remarked in an earlier lecture, we've been raising our hats ever since. The Warsaw press was full of references to Chopin. They regarded him as a local wonder boy, but Chopin knew that he still had to prove himself to the outside world. He left Poland when he was 20, intending to tour Europe and return home. Within weeks of his departure, however, the Warsaw insurrection broke out and was crushed by the Russians. Cut off from his native land, Chopin toured Vienna, Prague, and Stuttgart. It was at Stuttgart that he heard of the fall of Warsaw, and it was there, according to legend, that he wrote his revolutionary study. All his pent-up feelings came boiling to the surface in this angry, defiant music. As Chopin himself expressed it, "I can do nothing but pour out my grief on the piano." More by accident than design, Chopin wandered into Paris in the autumn of 1831. Aside from some brief excursions, he remained there for the rest of his life. The only way that he could earn a living was by teaching, and it was the wealthy aristocrats of the Polish diaspora who got him started. He was invited to play in the home of the Rothschild family, bankers to Europe, who recommended him to other aristocrats and set his fee at 20 francs a lesson, triple the usual amount for a piano teacher in those days. Chopin was soon teaching 4 or 5 students daily and was able to afford an elevated lifestyle with a manservant and a private carriage. He became a devoted teacher, and we know from the memories of his pupils that he put the best of himself into it. He liked to sit at a small cottage piano, illustrating his ideas on interpretation, while his pupils played on the pleyel grand that dominated his sitting room. The Pleyel, with its silvery tone and light action, was always his instrument of choice. He avoided the Erard, Pleyel's chief rival, considering it too heavy and unresponsive to the subtle nuances which characterized his own playing. As for the tuberculosis from which he suffered, it placed a heavy burden on his health. There were times when it was a simple inconvenience, and he could go about his daily duties with energy to spare. But there were others when his activities came to a virtual standstill, because the leaden weight of his symptoms meant that he could not function. During his lessons, it wasn't unusual to see him dab his forehead with eau de cologne, or to sip gum water laced with opium to ease the chronic inflammation of his throat. What sort of repertoire did Chopin recommend to his pupils? For technique, he liked to use the studies of Cramer and Clementi, especially Clementi's Gradus ad Parnassum, Steps to Parnassus, while for repertoire he taught works by Hummel, Weber, and Moscheles. And naturally, he gave lessons on his own pieces as well. Above all, he preferred Bach and Mozart. The 48 preludes and fugues by Bach were never far from his piano, and neither were the sonatas of Mozart, a repertoire he knew very well. One of his pupils, Friederike Müller, recalled one of her Sunday morning lessons, at the end of which Chopin sat down and played 14 of the preludes and fugues from memory, which must have taken up much of the rest of the day. When Chopin got up from the piano, all he would say was, "One doesn't forget that sort of thing." In fact, the 48 had been instilled in him from childhood by his teacher, Adalbert Gevigny. Chopin left detailed notes on his copy of the first volume of the 48, published several years ago by the French Institute of Musicology. They contain his metronome and expression marks, from which we come to understand how Chopin himself might have played these pieces. It's when we turn to the sketches of his unfinished piano method that Chopin's ideas on piano playing come tumbling from the page. The ideal playing position, according to Chopin, is when the five fingers are placed over the notes E, F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, and B. This conforms to the natural shape of the hand, and it's the most comfortable position for the player. Now, it follows from this that the simplest scale was B major, and that's the scale Chopin handed out to beginners. Likewise with arpeggios. The simplest arpeggio is not C major, it's the diminished seventh chord, starting on middle C. Overnight, Chopin had emancipated himself from the tyranny of C major and all its discomforts. It was the first time in the history of piano pedagogy that the comfort of the keyboard had become the first requirement. Heinrich Neuhaus, the celebrated teacher of Richter, Gilels, and others, observed that this first step was nothing short of inspired. He wrote, "You cannot find anything more natural on the keyboard than this position. Thanks to this simple exercise, the beginner immediately makes friends with the instrument and feels that the keyboard is not an alien, dangerous, and even hostile machine, but a familiar, friendly being, ready to meet you if you treat it lovingly and freely." And in a sentence that sheer poetry, Neuhaus added that the keyboard yearns for the closeness of the human hand, as the flower yearns for the approach of the bee, ready to yield all its pollen. All this helps to explain the large number of pieces by Chopin whose key signatures are loaded with sharps and flats. Neuhaus was puzzled by the fact that so many studies and exercises continue to be written in C major long after Chopin's death, and he observed with dry humor that it's difficult to find an explanation for this phenomenon, except for an excessive love of ivory and contempt for ebony. It's when we come to Chopin's 24 studies, opus 10 and 25, that we find the Copernicus of the piano on full display. These pieces occupy a unique place in the literature of the piano. They're the first such compositions to have made the hazardous journey from the practice studio to the concert hall, where they remain secure. Countless pieces called studies or exercises, composed by Czerny, Kramer, Clementi, Bertini, Moscheles, and many others, they've all failed to find a place in the Pantheon because they lack the superior musical content to place them there. Their treadmill figures continue to cast a blight on the happiness of piano students everywhere. By contrast, it's the sheer musical beauty and polish of Chopin's studies, each one in reality a miniature tone poem, that beguiles the ear and lingers in the memory. And by disdaining to provide them with an overarching title, such as we find in Clementi's Gradus ad Parnassum or Czerny's School of Velocity, Chopin avoids grounding his work in the field of keyboard gymnastics, leaving pedagogy with no foothold. Chopin had begun work on the studies when he was 19 years old and still in Warsaw, and he brought some of them to Paris with him in manuscript. Others soon followed, and by the summer of 1833, the first volume was complete. The third one, the one in E major, commands our attention because it's made its way around the world. Can any other so-called exercise make a similar claim? Chopin once admitted to one of his pupils, it was Adolf Gutmann, that he'd never written a melody to compare with this one. The purists, suspicious of its wide popularity, have always placed distance between themselves and this piece, dismissing it as hackneyed. Even the tasteless lyrics that Hollywood attached to the melody failed to destroy it, and they may even have prompted thousands of listeners to return to the original and partake of the magic at its source. Even before the first volume of studies was published, Chopin had begun work on the second, and in 1837, it appeared as 12 studies, opus 25. Several of these later pieces concentrate on a selected technical problem, arpeggios, thirds, sixths, and octaves. The study in G sharp minor, an exercise in swift-moving thirds in the right hand, offers a textbook example of Chopin's gift for turning treadmill figures into art of a high order. It's the gossamer lightness of the piece that lingers. The technical problem to be overcome, of course, is the lack of independence between the third and fourth fingers, joined from birth by a ligament, which Chopin described as the Siamese twins of the hand. The American critic James Huneker put the matter very well when he said that this study is first music, and only when its beauty has sunk in do we even think of it as containing a technical problem, an interesting reversal of concepts that could apply to the entire set. Thank you. Chopin originally began his winter wind study, the one in A minor, opus 25, number 11, with a spectacular plunge into the abyss. The slow four-bar introduction with which we're all now familiar was added later at the suggestion of one of Chopin's Polish piano-playing friends, Dr. Alexander Hoffmann, a physician who lodged with him in Paris and who'd known Chopin since their childhood. Chopin played the study to Hoffmann, who felt it needed a preface. Always reluctant to make any major changes to his music once it reached its final form, Chopin at first refused. But Hoffmann's suggestion grew on him and became one that he liked. One morning, we're told, he came down and played the new version to Hoffmann. This slow introduction, a preview of the study's main theme, throws the incoming Allegro con brio into marvelous relief, and the Copernicus of the piano proceeds to ride the storm. With his 24 studies, Chopin attained a position in the realm of piano music that can only be described as unassailable, a position that he's occasionally been asked to share, but from which he's never been dislodged. These matchless compositions may also be understood as a gateway to Chopin's music generally, for there are few technical hurdles in his output that are not foreshadowed here, and the solutions are evident at every touch and turn. Of all the great composer pianists, Chopin enjoyed the briefest career, appearing no more than 20 times in the major concert halls of Europe before a paying public. He preferred to play to an inner circle of friends, and he generally came into his own in the salons of the aristocracy, where the atmosphere was relaxed and informal. We know from contemporary portraits that he played with hands and fingers close to the keyboard, hardly ever raising his arms and never creating those flamboyant gestures beloved of the typical virtuoso. Chopin disparaged them and described their actions as catching pigeons, a reminder that for him, good piano playing was a horizontal and not a vertical activity, the vertical plane being a place where spectacle is born. He was the antithesis of the thunder and lightning school of playing, which came to dominate the 19th century and distort Chopin's own music. His favorite piano, as I remarked earlier, was the silvery-toned Pleyel with its easy action. How extraordinary to think that Chopin's passionate music was composed on this relatively simple instrument with a keyboard compass of a mere 6 octaves, 72 keys. There are two important techniques of composition which are regular features of Chopin's creative process. I want to mention them here because they spring out of his daily contact with the keyboard, and they're symptomatic of the kind of discoveries that would have come to light during moments of improvisation. It's well known that Chopin preferred to compose at the keyboard and was hardly able to compose anything away from it. We can call the first of these techniques the apotheosis of themes, the recasting of simple melodies brought back clothed in grandeur, so to speak. Chopin provides some telling examples in his ballads especially. Let's hear the second subject of the ballad in G minor, opus 23, which Chopin first presents in this simple, straightforward form. When Chopin recapitulates this theme, he apotheosizes it. That is to say, he elevates it to one of the grand climaxes of the ballad. Listen to how he takes that earlier theme and lets the glory in. Chopin didn't invent the technique of apotheosis. It goes back at least to Beethoven in such works as the Choral Symphony, with its wonderful transformation of finale's main theme, and that great outburst in the Ode to Joy. But the Romantics made the device very much their own, and it turns up in Chopin all the time. The other technique is known as developing variation. The term was introduced by Arnold Schoenberg, but the process it describes was already more than 200 years old when Schoenberg coined those words. They describe to perfection a method that became a trademark effect in Chopin, namely the practice of loading a simple melody with an increasing abundance of ornamentation at each repetition. At its typical best, the model is pushed ever further into the background as each repetition is called upon to bear the weight of yet greater layers of decoration. Chopin's music teems with examples, but his early Nocturne in F-sharp major, opus 15, can stand for the others. Here's the opening melody, presented in its basic form, its outline unadorned. I've chosen the celebrated recording by Dame Myra Hess, whose beautiful tone was surely a legacy of her studies with Tobias Matthay. When Chopin recapitulates that melody, he does more than simply repeat it. He recomposes it, subjecting it to developing variation. The original theme is now covered with cascades of decorations, lending it the trappings of the fioritura singer. Chopin's recapitulations are hardly ever mere repetitions, but are instead marvels of recreation, as the old is rendered ever new. His recapitulations have been likened to a return to the homeland after a long journey. There are historical precedents for developing variation, of course, and we find them at every touch and turn in Chopin's beloved Mozart, whose music, both operatic and instrumental, provides textbook examples of the process in action. And now, a final question. Can you think of a piece by Chopin that qualifies him as one of the prophets of the 19th century, a composer who looked farther into the future of music than any of his contemporaries? I believe that there might be one such piece. I'm referring to the finale of the Sonata in B-flat minor, the so-called Funeral March Sonata. Lasting just over 1 minute in performance, it serves as a peroration to the celebrated funeral march itself. My guess is that if you'd never heard this music before, if you didn't know the famous sonata from which it comes, you would never accept that it was composed by Chopin. Anton Rubinstein came up with a memorable phrase when he likened it to night winds sweeping across churchyard graves. But it was more than that, as we'll see. this futuristic music was composed in 1839, when Chopin was 29 years old. For sheer modernity, you'll find nothing to compare with it up to that time, and for half a century afterwards. It stands alone, completely isolated. It's not only athematic, it's also atonal. Listen to the iconic performance by Rachmaninov, an interpretation that forever changed the direction in which this movement would be performed. There's an old Chinese proverb that says, when a wise man points to the stars, only a fool looks at his finger. Most of Chopin's contemporaries were looking in the wrong place when they found this music incomprehensible. Berlioz was bewildered by it. Mendelssohn was repelled by it. Robert Schumann didn't regard it as music at all and thought that it should never have found its way into a sonata. But today we hear it differently. We belong to the generation which has lived through the age of atonality, through the age of 12-tone music, and through the rendering of dissonances so extreme that we've learned through repetition how to make them consonant. In brief, we hear this music as members of that future for whom it was written. Here, if anywhere, the image of Chopin as the Copernicus of the piano seems appropriate. This music, like so much else in Chopin, is timeless in its infinity, and it will surely go on sounding for as long as the piano recital itself endures.